ASML is one of TSMC's big suppliers and the only maker of EUV machines in the world. They make the machines that TSMC uses to fab its chips. But there is so much more to semiconductor production than just photolithography. I want to continue my series on the industry supply chain with another multi-billion dollar semiconductor equipment supplier that flies under the radar, Tokyo Electron Limited, or TEL. They are Japan's biggest semiconductor equipment maker and one of its most valuable companies with a $68 billion market cap. That is as big as Nintendo or Honda. In this video, we will look at Tokyo Electron's history, what they actually do, and where they are within the semiconductor manufacturing supply chain. In the meanwhile, we will get to learn more about the process of making a semiconductor. But first, yes, let us talk a bit about the Patreon. If you want to help support the channel, you might want to take a look at the Early Access tier. Early Access members get to see a large backlog of videos queued up and waiting to be released to the public. Right now, there are over 15 videos in Early Access. So head on over to the Patreon page and take a look. I deeply appreciate anything you'd be able to sign up for. Thank you, and on with the show. Tokyo Electron Research Institute began over 50 years ago as a small independent trading company. Founded in November 1963 by Tokuo Kubo and Toshio Okada, they started off with just 6 employees. Tokyo Broadcasting System, a large Japanese TV station, saw their potential and invested 5 million yen into their company. TBS still has a 4% stake to this day, now worth over $2 billion. On a side note, some American and British hedge funds have been pressuring TBS to sell their shares in Tokyo Electron and other investments to boost their stock price. Interesting times. At first, TEL sold pretty much anything. They were just one of many such electronics trading companies in Japan. Over half of their sales came from importing and selling car radios, calculators, and car stereos. Their big break came in 1965 when the company signed an import contract with American semiconductor maker Fairchild to import their integrated circuit testers. The company then leveraged that experience to sign another import contract for a critical semiconductor production item, diffusion furnaces from the American firm Thermco. More on what that does later. Like with the Chinese market today, American companies in the 1960s could not enter the Japanese market without first forming a joint venture with a local affiliate. These contracts were clearly geared towards technology transfer. The Japanese sought to leverage access to its market to acquire technology and build up its own national champions. Such practices remain controversial to this day, but Tokyo Electron clearly benefited from the joint venture. And by investing in R&D, they were able to come up with products of their own for the market. For Tokyo Electron, the big turning point came in 1973. The 1970s saw multiple economic crises like the dollar shock of 1971, a result of the Plaza Accords, and the oil crisis of 1973. In the midst of the economic crisis in 1973, Tokyo Electron decided that it would divest its consumer electronics import business entirely. They would then focus on being the best manufacturer of semiconductor production equipment that they can be. This was risky as the consumer electronics import division represented 60% of the company's revenues, but leadership believed that semiconductor manufacturing equipment had higher value add. Consumer electronics goods drove revenue but had low margins. It would not be long before that business died off. The move was completed in 1975. The next year, revenues grew 13% and profit 97%. The results validated the difficult decision. In 1980, the company listed its shares on the Tokyo Stock Exchange. Japan's semiconductor industry saw its peak throughout the 1980s. Companies like NEC, Mitsubishi Electric, Hitachi and Toshiba explored the cutting edge of semiconductor manufacturing and dominated the market. Tokyo Electron became one of their top suppliers, and its customer success was its own. But as the 1990s came around, low-cost Japanese DRAM exports became a political issue. Japanese companies in the semiconductor industry build massive overcapacity per national economic policy, and they then dump that capacity overseas, sparking trade disputes. Here's an off-sided example. 256K DRAM prices in January 1985, before Japanese entry into the market, were about $17 per unit. After Japanese entry, prices cratered to under $4 by August that same year. The Japanese industry's per unit cost of production, $6.34. the American semiconductor industry successfully lobbied to place limits on their Japanese competitors. Combined with the yen's appreciation, Japan pulled back. Again, Tokyo Electron faced a major threat to its business. In 1992, 80% of the company's revenues came out of Japan. But as semiconductors in Japan declined, it rose in other places around the world. An opportunity existed to meet their needs. So throughout the 1990s, Tokyo Electron expanded their direct sales operations abroad to the United States, Europe, Taiwan, and South Korea. Their continued investment in R&D to create cutting-edge products led to new customers like Intel, Samsung, and TSMC. And today, their income is very international. In fiscal year 2020, Japan now accounts for less than 15% of their total revenues. The company's size and importance is such that when Applied Materials attempted to acquire them in 2013 for $9 billion, the antitrust enforcement agencies in the United States, EU, and South Korea all sued to stop it. The combined company would have controlled over 25% of the entire supercritical semiconductor production equipment industry. The merger was eventually called off in 2015, disappointing top management. But since the company today is worth north of $65 billion, I think they're doing all right. Okay, I've talked enough about TEL's history. What on earth do they actually sell? Tokyo Electron is different from ASML because they do not build super sexy, ultra cutting edge machinery like lithography steppers. There are no tin droplets or lasers here. Rather, Tokyo Electron's products span the entire semiconductor manufacturing chain. Their technologies help create not only the logic processor chips that power your devices, but also flat panel displays in those devices' screens as well. I don't want to bore y'all with a long lecture, so I'm going to focus on just four of their most critical semiconductor production business lines: lithography coating slash developing, deposition, dry etch, and cleaning. These are the lines in which TEL has strong market share as of 2017. These lines serve certain steps within what is called the front end of semiconductor manufacturing. TEL does offer packaging and inspection machinery, essential steps in what is labeled the back end, but I'm going to exclude those for now. In the future, I will do a video exploring advanced packaging technologies. The goal of the front end is to turn a pure, unpatterned silicon wafer into a structured wafer. That wafer then gets cut into its individual dies, so one single structured wafer might have hundreds or even thousands of dies within it. A single structured wafer has many layers to it. Inside your fab, wafers go through a bunch of development steps many times. Each step adds or modifies those layers until the final design meets the customer's goals. TEL's products contribute to some of these individual steps. These steps do not always go in a neat sequential order. Some are repeated many times before going to another step. It all really depends on the design. Also note, I am absolutely not looking to be comprehensive of the whole process. I just want to give a general overview of what TEL's products do. Deposition. Deposition is a general phrase for putting down a metal layer onto a substrate or wafer surface. There are a number of reasons you would want to do this. For instance, if you want to deposit layers of copper to create connections between the devices within your integrated circuit. Tokyo Electron offers devices that do this with various elements and in various ways. For instance, their NT333 system, which performs a technique called atomic layer deposition. The NT333 combines several precursor chemicals or reactants to apply a film of chemicals onto the wafer. It does this by exposing one chemical after the other in an alternating sequence so that what is left is an even, uniform layer. The NT333 is notable compared to its competitors because it is able to do this in what TEL calls semi-batches, which means they can do more wafers at once. Batch work means less fine control, but saves cost. The NT333 attempts to offer the best of both worlds. There are other deposition techniques that TEL's products can do. For instance, its Tilindi Plus system, which performs thermal processing. Its furnace uses heat to initiate a reaction of a precursor gas, so to deposit a thin, even layer of chemicals onto wafer batches. This business line is one of TEL's oldest. Remember that deal with Thermco? There you go. Coating and developing. These two are a pair of substeps within another step called photomasking. In photomasking, we coat the wafer with a UV-sensitive resin called a photoresist that basically masks it. Kind of like when painting a car, you put a protective covering on the windshield to keep it from getting painted on. This step is referred to as coating. Then you expose the wafer to UV light, or in the case of EUV, extreme UV light. This is where ASML's $150 million EUV steppers would be used, projecting the chip pattern onto the wafer. What that pattern is depends on the chip designer's specification. You end up with an exposed photoresist and a protected photoresist. A solvent can then be applied that washes away the unwanted parts of the photoresist. What that might be, the exposed or unexposed part, depends on the type of photoresist used. That rinsing step is called developing. TEL's coating and developing machines are branded as the CleanTrack and Lithius Pro Z. Now that we have the remaining photoresist to guide you, it is time to etch away onto the layer. Think of it as having drawn an outline of your hand onto a block of wood. Now you can cut away everything outside of the outline. There are two ways of doing the etching. There is the wet etching, which uses liquids, or dry etching, which uses a gaseous compound like oxygen and chloride. TEL's machines do the latter. Tokyo Electron's industry-leading dry etch system is called the Tactress. This machine shoots a stream of gas plasma that is able to do the etching in a uniform and accurate manner. Announced in 2006 but first shipped in 2010, the machine costs about $4 to $9 million back then. But if you don't want to spend that much, you can visit the GlobalFoundries surplus and used equipment website and buy a gently used etch machine from there. Hopefully they'll give you free shipping. Cleaning. 30 to 40% of the steps in modern wafer fabrication involve some form of wafer cleaning. Naturally, it is really important. The idea is simple. After the aforementioned steps, you need to clean off any chemical or particle impurities. Otherwise, those impurities will drastically affect your wafer yields. Oh, and you have to do the cleaning without leaving any damage. Wafer cleaning comes in many forms and variations. It is not just one thing. For instance, there is photoresist cleaning, where you take off the photoresist layer after the etching step is completed. There is a clean step for particle contamination, where you remove particles using extremely strong acids, and so on. Tokyo Electron's brand of cleaning systems is the Celesta, which sounds to me like a brand of salsa, and the machine can handle about 1,000 wafers per hour. Like with the dishwasher at a restaurant, the more wafers you can put through the machine, the better. Alright, that's it for Tokyo Electron's business lines. I hope this section helped you better understand the breadth of this billion-dollar company's business. Tokyo Electron is a pretty low-key company considering how big of a role it plays in the semiconductor manufacturing industry. Finding information about them was pretty difficult, but without their contributions, the industry as a whole will struggle to function. When I read the press and mainstream articles surrounding semiconductor manufacturing, I tend to see a lot of the same names. You see TSMC, Samsung, and Intel, of course, and lately you're starting to see ASML and the word EUV show up a lot too. With all of this chatter flying around, I think it is easy to get drawn into a belief that semiconductor production leadership, or capacity, is basically dependent on ASML shipping a bunch of EUV machines. I can see the comments now. ASML has a monopoly on EUV machines, blah blah blah, no one can catch up, so ASML greater than TSMC slash Intel slash Samsung slash Tokyo Electron and so on. I keep talking about this. It takes a massive village to make the chips inside your phones, GPUs, and cars. Tokyo Electron's very history is testament to the industry's global nature. Without systems from international companies like Tokyo Electron, those expensive EUV machines are useless. You do not skip steps. It all has to be there for the final product to work as well as it does. I have always really been impressed with how foundries get all of these machines to work together in harmony to churn out tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of wafers each month. Exploring what companies like Tokyo Electron do only deepens that sentiment. A multi-million dollar machine for this tiny step that nobody talks about. No other word for it. Wow. Just wow. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. If you want more content, you can like and subscribe to the channel. I would like it if you did. Or check out the Patreon if you want to support the work and watch any of the early access videos. Or send me an email. Drop me a line at john@asianometry.com. I love getting letters from viewers. Stay safe out there. Until next time, I'll see you guys later.